This is Law of One, Session 64. We're continuing. July 26, 1981, received. This is 21 exchanges, and we finished the first seven or six last time. Long discussion ending last time, 64-6. The spiritual practices, the spiritual work of Ra in late sixth density to continue their own evolution into seventh density, and how they too are balancing, but from the perspective of unity. And these quotes, I won't go over the whole answer of 64-6 again, but Ra is really providing another way of thinking about the level of higher self, the achievement of what's called unified self, or the law of one, and an analysis of creation, or the seven-dimensional octave, from the perspective of unity. And they don't do the work of surrounding themselves in light. They have become light, or they've realized that their nature is light, based on an understanding that there's no other material except light. Light, of course, is intelligent energy. Light, love, love, light. The basis of the seven frequencies or colors or seven rays or dimensions and seven energy bodies. The basis of the seven rays is the one of intelligent energy, which is called light. Its nature is love, infinite love. And there's no material except light. All seven densities can be seen as material. Yet this is a concept. And Ra talked about the concept of light. That's why Ra said you are dancing thoughts. You're not living in a material universe. You are dancing thoughts. Now, why didn't Ra say you are light? Because they already know that essential identity is the logos. And the vehicles of experience are all of light, meaning the seven rays, which compose, which are, you know, differentiations of, manifestations or composites of seven rays, form, body, mind, spirit, and the vehicles of experience for higher self and even the seventh density entity. Their body level, their mind activity, are all manifestations of light, or seven-ray frequency fields, whose nature is light, whose nature is love, whose true identity is the logos. And so their search has become internalized. As we become light, love, and love, light, they become, or they realize that their nature is intelligent energy. From that, they will realize that that level of identity is still not essential, because light is a concept in the mind of the infinite, or light is a concept projected or experienced by intelligent infinity itself. Intelligent infinity discerns the concept of infinity, thereby gives rise to the concept of light, which gives rise to the seven dimensions, which are the illusion, which constitutes the illusion of limits. These are phrases that are very critical to understand. So anyway, their search is internalized, and our search may be understood to be internalized when you realize that the supposedly outer world is not outer. The supposedly inner mind is not inner. The mind and the supposed, you know, the apparent inner mind and the apparent outer world is one field. And that's the field of light. And that recognition is akin to the internalization of the search, as Ra says they're doing. The new material starts 64-7. Don's asking, would it be helpful if Ra were to describe the techniques used while Ra was in third density to evolve in mind, body, and spirit? Ra said, this query lies beyond the law of confusion. No, it's an infringement. We can't tell you what we did in third density. But you see, they have a lot. They've talked extensively, actually, about their their social harmony and the use of spiritual sexuality or spiritual use of sexuality. They talked about their use with their training with pyramid and crystal healing. So, you know, and the tarot. So they actually gave a lot. But Dawn pushes it, and we see 64.8. What about fourth density experience of Ra? Would that also lie beyond the law of confusion, meaning the law of free will, meaning is it infringement on free will to speak it? If not, if it is an infringement, then it's another matter of not violating the our right to remain confused. The law of free will as the law of confusion. Violation of the law of free will is a violation of the spiritual or universal benefit of allowing a being to remain in its confusion so that it has the opportunity to remove its confusion itself, which is called soul evolution, the removal of confusion. And taking that away from somebody is a form of violation. And so that's why talking to people, giving them truth they don't want, talking too much, talking at the wrong time, over-talking, cutting people off even. I mean, I'm guilty of all this sometimes. But all very subtle forms of wrong speech or unskillful speech, even in service to other, are ultimately subtle violations of the law of free will, or beyond the law of confusion, because it somehow damages the current confusion of the mind of the other, who is not seeking help from us in that case. They're seeking measured help. Maybe they're just seeking unconditional acceptance. They just seek to be heard. They just listen to me is all they really want. Let me speak. Not, I want to hear you tell me this and that. Now, they may ask that, and then it's appropriate. But if they don't ask that, and they're just speaking, it's really the higher service to offer the unconditional acceptance of a spacious field in which we may let them have their freedom and not infringe on their current condition, which is, again, actually allowing them to work their own way through their own confusion. So, an understanding of non-infringement grows more subtle as one's wisdom grows along the path too. And now Ra basically says the fourth density experience, their fourth density experience, does also lie beyond the law of confusion. And their answer to, you know, Don asking about how about your 4D experience, Ra said, you know, this is correct, meaning it also, you know, explaining it also lies, is an infringement of the law of free will. You guys got to figure out what fourth density work is. So, Ra says 64.8, this is correct. Let us express a thought. Ra is not elite. To speak of our specific experiences to a group which honors us is to guide to the point of a specific advising. Our work was that of your peoples, of experiencing the catalyst of joys and sorrows. Our circumstances were somewhat more harmonious. Let it be said that any entity or group may create the most splendid harmony in any outer atmosphere. Ra's experiences are no more than your own. Yours is the dance at this space-time in third density harvest. So, the harvest is now. The physical domain is space-time. Your dancing thoughts. the flickering of consciousness. Or restlessness, ninth fetter in Buddhism, is the dancing. Light itself is polarized. That's why we say light, love, love, light. That's why there's yin-yang. That's what comes down to the polarity of wisdom, love, or receptivity, reflectivity, male, female, day, night, positive, negative path. All of that is the basis of dancing. Ra is saying, we're not elite. And interestingly, they're saying this is actually a window to the Elder Confederation perspective associated with why they don't land on the White House lawn and why any government operative, such as there have been many and continue to be, who claims the Positive Confederation is working directly with humanity or secret military groups is probably deceived or deceiving or mistaken, because they're saying to speak to a group which honors us, if you think we're great, and to tell you exactly what's going on for us is, in their view, an infringement. To guide to a point of specific advising, because you think we're so wonderful, because you look up to us, if we simply explain so much about our process, you're going to feel that you should do the same. But Ra's not saying you should do what we did. And they're saying, you know, don't look up to us. Look to yourselves and look to your path. And so they too experience the catalyst of joys and sorrows. That's what life's about, actually. That's very much the progression from self-consciousness and third density to higher self. Joy and sorrow is the result of desire. Successful achievement of desire leads to joy. The degradation of that experience leads to sorrow. The loss of the inability to acquire the object of desire, inability to acquire, is of sorrow. The loss of the preferred object is sorrow. The degradation of the experience in mind after achievement of desire is sorrow. All the bitter taste of loss, based on impermanence and anatta. The impermanence, the insubstantiality of all feelings, they all degrade. You know, I buy this beautiful bracelet, what a beautiful mineral, stone, and the first few days I feel joy, and 3 months later I don't. I don't feel much of anything. Maybe I like it, but it doesn't tickle my fancy anymore. So even joy degrades. And that's the experience, basically, of grasping or seeking till the point when we're free from seeking, ultimately in seventh density. Their experiences were more harmonious, obviously, and making a splendid harmony in outer atmosphere, meaning a beautiful planetary civilization, is not a very difficult matter. You know, technology won't save us. Morality and sincerity might. Morality is the basis of the right use of technology. Morality is the basis of the right use of mind, the right use of will. And with morality, which really means, you know, true virtue. It doesn't mean goody two-shoes, it means true virtue. Harmlessness, non-infringement, honesty, you know? The one for all and all for one. With that, it's not difficult to make a splendid, harmonious outer atmosphere. But obviously, Earth humanity is incapable of that morality. 64.9. The question was brought up recently, having to do with possible records left near or in or under the Great Pyramid at Giza. I have no idea whether this would be a benefit. I will just ask if there's any benefit in investigating in that area. And Ross says, we apologize for seeming to be so shy of information. However, any words upon this particular subject create the possibility of infringement upon free will. So Ross is bang, 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 saying, we can't talk about our experience in third density. We can't talk about our experience in fourth density. We can't talk about records left near, in, under the Great Pyramid of Giza. You see, what's happening here is that the level of metaphysical dialogue has deepened so much so to session 64, in my opinion, that transient questions can't be entertained more so than before. The transient material has been vacated, has been vented, and when you get to a deep level of working alone or with a teacher, the standards increase. And of much, you know, he who has much is expected. And so Ra continues to hold a tight line here to Don and to us, saying, focus upon essentials, please. You shouldn't copy us, but you should certainly investigate, you know, turn the light inward, turn the light upon yourself. That's the spiritual path. And there's less space at this point for transient discussion. 6410. But this does seem to indicate, yes, there are records in or near or under the Great Pyramid. 6410. In a previous session, Don says, which was session 63, question 3, now we're getting back into the biorhythm discussion. Don says, 6410, in a previous session, you mentioned the gateway of magic for the adept occurring in 18-day cycles. Could you expand on that information, please? This is the adept cycle. Ra explains, the mind-body-spirit complex is born under a series of influences, both lunar, planetary, cosmic, and in some cases, karmic. The moment of the birthing into this illusion begins the cycles we have mentioned, which are cycles of body and intellect and adept, and body, emotional, intellectual, and adept, the four cycles. The spiritual or adept cycle, which is the fourth cycle, the spiritual or adept cycle is an 18-day cycle and operates with the qualities of the sine wave. Thus, there are a few excellent days on the positive side of the curve, that being the first 9 days of the cycle, precisely the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth, when workings are most appropriately undertaken, given that the entity is still without total conscious control of its mind-body-spirit distortion reality. The most interesting portion of this information, like that of each cycle, is the noting of the critical point wherein passing from the 9th to the 10th and from the 18th to the 1st days, the adept will experience some difficulty, especially when there is a transition occurring in another cycle at the same time. At the nadir of each cycle, meaning the low point, the adept will be at its least powerful, but will not be open to difficulties in nearly the same degree that it experiences at critical times. So there are a lot of interesting principles here. Number one, the entity, called mind-body-spirit complex, at birth is born under or born at the time of a particular composite or confluences of multiple influences, a series or a composite of multiple influences, lunar of the moon, planetary, associated with Earth and location, cosmic, meaning astrology and the adept cycle, and in some cases karmic. To me, it seems always karmic. So I don't know why Ross says sometimes, some cases karmic. Seems to me it's always the whole the whole gestalt of such influences is in the karmic stream, obviously. Then, the moment of the birthing into this illusion, 3D space-time, begins the cycles. We've mentioned all of the cycles, so we're multiple cycles, okay? So say we're at the moon, and it's a 28-day cycle, the planet, and it's, rotation around the sun, and other energy cycles of the year, annual cycle, cosmic, astrology, and very subtle ones, too, and then karmic, of course, always. But karmic cycle is different than karmic influence, so that's what Ra's talking about, but that's too subtle for right now. The fourth of the biorhythm cycles that Ra presented is called the spirit or the spiritual cycle or the adept cycle, the gateway of magic. 18 days, like a sine wave, goes up, goes down, goes up, goes down. You've got basically, you can divide the sine wave into four. First, you divide the full wave into two. That which is above a linear horizontal baseline. That which is above is 18 is 9 days. That which is below is another 9 days. But within the 9 days above and the 9 days below of the two portions of the sine wave, in that which is above and that which is below, you've got that which is ascending and then descending. And then for the one below, you've got that which is descending and that which changes trajectory to the ascending. Okay? So you've got four of ascending above the line, four and a half, and you've got four and a half descending above the midline or the horizontal baseline. Then you have 4.5 descending below the baseline and 4.5 beginning to ascend below the baseline. So you've got ascension above, descension above, descension below, ascension below. If you can figure that out. And now we have a helicopter nearby. So, interestingly, Ross saying the 4th and the 5th and the 6th are considered excellent because they're the most high of the ascending half cycle of above the baseline. So those are the most opportune. But, you know, I wouldn't guide my life this way. So, and Ra's not saying you should either. Ra didn't say you should have the sessions in concordance with assessment of the most opportune days. Ra didn't say that at all. So, you know, astrology is there, but God is here also, to paraphrase Nityananda. So, also interestingly, Ra talks about, you know, that if you want to do this kind of timing of magical working in association with those particular days, the most excellent days on the of the ascending arc above the baseline, the positive side of the curve, that's useful for everybody, yeah, sure, who still has karma or is still not, you know, fully enlightened, meaning, and Ra gives a phrase for that, being still without total conscious control of its mind-body-spirit distortion reality. Mind-body-spirit complex is a mind-body-spirit complex is a distortion. It's basically, again, it's a, you know, a transient field of energies, seven array energies, but it's a distortion because it's not yet perfectly harmonized internally or to intelligent energy. But it's our reality, apparent reality, without total conscious control. Control doesn't mean negative path service to self controlling. It's about mastery, self-mastery. And that's the difference between a Buddha or lords of karma or those that are free of samsara or seven-dimensional rebirth. They are masters of the seven dimensions. And it's, you can say total control, but you can say mastery, but it doesn't mean domination and controlling of anybody against free will, obviously. So, just different words can be used. And again, Ra is saying that what is actually dangerous or what are the periods of difficulty in the 18-day cycle are nodal points, transitional points, passing from the 9th to the 10th, basically going from at the descensional portion of that which is above the baseline, the ending of that which is above the baseline, to the beginning of that of the 9 days that are below the baseline, 9 to 10, 18 to 1. Interestingly, that baseline is sort of like it's similar to dawn, it's sunrise, sunset. The moment of sunrise can be considered as 18 to 1. The moment of sunset is the transition of 9 to 10, we may say, analogously. And at the nadir of that there's some kind of, you know, it's considered metaphysically that these are sacred moments. The moment of sunrise and the moment of sunset. These are sacred in the sense that they're phase shifts. They're moments of phase shifting. And it's very common, of course, that spiritual practice is done at sunrise and sunset in different traditions. So, interesting, you know, aspects, little information here for people who are involved in cycles management. 6411. Then to find the cycles, we would take the instant of birth and the emerging of the infant into or from the mother into this density and start the cycle at that instant and continue it through the life. Is this correct? Ross said, this is mostly correct. It's not necessary to identify the instant of birthing, interestingly. The diurnal cycle upon which this event occurs is satisfactory for all but the most fine workings. So, you see, this is a matter of magnification of analysis. Is it important? Is it not important? Well, it depends on how much you wish to magnify your focus. It depends on how meticulous you wish to be. Is it important? Is it not? Well, depending on your motivation or your need or the need for which you're doing the analysis, it's important or not. Ross says it's not necessary to identify the instant of birthing, but it surely is if you want most fine workings. So is it or isn't? It depends on that which you're attempting or what the objective is. So in most cases, sure, it's good enough to just take the day of birth for what? Determination of astrological cycles and the biorhythm cycles, the four cycles of body, emotion, or physical, emotional, intellectual, and adept. Sure, you can just take the day. But some people want to do most fine workings. And, most fine workings means highly meticulous. Then, yes, indeed, you need to know the instant of birth. I mean, who knows that? But, the degree of focus depends on the objective for which you're focusing, for which you're involved in that seeking. Do you seek a fine, precisional comprehension or a basic overview? This is critical. And so you can know in detail, in depth, and precisionally if you seek such. 64.12, Don goes on, now, am I correct in assuming that whatever magic the adept would perform would be more successful, or shall we say, more to his design than that performed at less opportune times in the cycle? Talking about magic, adepts doing white magic, correlating, synchronizing that ritual activity to particular days of the 18-day cycle for the adept. Yep, seems to be. Ross said, yeah, this cycle is a helpful tool to the adept. Yeah. But as we said, as the adept becomes more balanced, the workings designed will be dependent less and less upon these cycles of opportunity and more even in their efficacy. And that's the point. Ra is not recommending we do this. Again, they did not recommend that the group hold sessions in accord with the adept cycle or any other cycle. They didn't say it's useless. This is called, fine discernment. It is helpful. It's a knowing the cycles, doing white magic in accord with the cycles, and you black magicians listening will do your thing too. For those doing magic, for adepts doing ritual, yeah, it's helpful to accord activity with the most favorable, beneficent cycle days, yeah. But particularly for the positive path, as we become more balanced, the efficacy of workings, I'm not doing white magic, so I'm not interested in this, but the more, if we're talking about efficacy of workings, the more balanced the entity, the more efficacious, the more successful, the more potent, the more, positively effective the activity or ritual will be, as the entity becomes more and more balanced, which means more and more purified of lower triad blockages, obviously. So while cycle analysis and synchronization may be useful, to focus on this is beneath you, frankly, in my view. It's beneath the law of one. And, again, cycles are there, but God is here too, to paraphrase Nityananda. 64.13, Don says, I have no ability to judge whether, at what point, at what level of abilities, the adept would reach this point of being, shall we say, independent of the cyclic action. That wasn't Ra's phrase, but it's one way of looking at it. Can you give me an indication of what level of adeptness that would be necessary to be so independent? Ra said, we are fettered from speaking specifically due to this group's work, for to speak would seem to be to judge. However, we may say that you may consider this cycle in the same light as the so-called astrological balances within your group. That is, they are interesting but not critical. And that's the mature perspective on all cycles influential upon the human being, in my view. The physical cycle associated with physical body, and the emotional and intellectual, and the adept cycle, the four, you know, the three biorhythms, physical, emotional, intellectual, and the adept's 18-day cycle, astrological, lunar, planetary. They are interesting, they are influential, but they're not critical. And so the adept is not independent of cyclical action. It is that the adept is unswayed by cyclical influence. Don't become the fox in the back of the temple. The awakened one is not free of karma. The awakened one is one with karma, and that non-separation is freedom. Unification or non-duality is the heart of moksha, liberation, freedom. And so, yes, as far as I know, yeah, the adept, even fully balanced, a crystallized healer, is affected by cyclical energy influences, or energy of cyclical influence. Multiple cyclical influences of energy does affect an adept, does affect everybody, but they're not swayed by it. It's like the difference between the person who's upset at the rain and the person who keeps walking and you know, notices it and keeps going and continues their thought or meditation or whatever. Yes, it's raining on me. There was some story, I think, of a Tibetan Lama who was given LSD. This is a story, I don't know if it's really true. A long time ago. And, the disciples, Westerners, were saying, wow, what are you feeling? What's going on? Are you tripping? And the Lama calmly said something like, I'm hallucinating. Like, yeah, okay, illusory visual images are projecting in the mind now. Yeah, whatever. So, the cycles affect us, and it is interesting, and it can be helpful to know them, for sure. But they're not critical. Atman lives beyond the cycles. The law of one is transcyclic. 6414, thank you, Don says. I read that recent research has indicated that the normal sleep cycle for entities on this planet occurs 1 hour later each diurnal period, meaning day, so that we have a 25-hour cycle instead of a 24. Is this correct? And if so, why is this? Ross says, this is in some cases correct. The planetary influences from which those of Mars experience memory have some effect upon these third density physical body complexes. This race, Martian, has given its genetic material to many, in brackets, bodies upon your plane, which is a very fine bracket inclusion there. So, Ra seems to be suggesting that in association with the Martian soul transfer 75,000 years ago, there is transfer of some Martian origin genetic material now in the physical bodies of lots of folks who are alive today, I guess, in which there is some kind of normal sleep cycle advancement of 1 hour later each day, so that there's some kind of 25-hour cycle. I don't know what this thing really means, but they experience a 25-hour cycle that's related to the sleep patterns or the biorhythms of the biology and brain chemistry. Of course, it's pegged to a 25-hour cycle, not 24, but that's associated with the Martian. And that's, you know, that the interesting point to me is just that genetic material of 3D Earth human bodies now may be correspondent to or influenced by or analogous to or identical to in some corresponding way the genetics of beings on Mars over 75,000 years ago. So we are utilizing Martian genetics somewhat. You know, I'm not a geneticist, but it does seem that, at least in this case, the transfer of souls from Mars to Earth also included the recapitulation or recreation, reassembling, reestablishing, or carry through of some of the Martian genetics in their 3D bodies, 3D spacetime bodies, to the bodies of people living on Earth. Okay. 6415. Don says thank you again. And here's a big answer associated with healing. Very interesting. It's maybe getting close to the end of our talking here. Don says, Ra mentioned the ones Stuart and Douglas in a recent session. That was session 62. These are members of what we call our medical profession. What is the value, overall value, shall I say, of modern medical techniques in alleviating bodily distortions with respect to the purpose for these distortions and what we might call karma and other effects? Which is a very interesting question. What are the dynamics of allopathic medical intervention in assisting healing of people in relation to the karmic basis of such illness or symptomatic condition of the body of the person, the patient, as being a catalyst for mind learning? To what extent can the person learn, or to what extent does medical allopathic intervention that cures symptoms actually help when the purpose for which the illness or pathological condition of body, the basis for its formation was a needed balancing in mind, or the development of particular attitudes or adjustments in view? Like, I should be more patient, or I should love myself more, or it would be helpful. You know, it's a matter of not should, particularly. I use the word should, it's habit, but it would be more helpful and beneficial to me if I adjust my attitudes and not cause myself this illness. You know, like the businessman with the ulcer who's impatient. The woman who needs sleeping pills because she can't sleep. Why? Because she's distraught with worry. Why? Because there's certain things she hasn't thought through, which she should, or ought to, for her own benefit. Think it through. Then you'll be able to get to sleep, because your insomnia may be the result of blockage in the thinking through process of the very real problems that you ought to discover solutions to, you know? So people can't sleep. Why? Because I'm thinking too much. About what? About real problems, perhaps, or usually, that the person needs to comprehend and analyze out discover the nature of the problem or the solution. But they take a little sleeping pill and they go to sleep. And the real problems remain uncomprehended. And that leads to more trouble in one's life. So you take the sleeping pill, and you end up hurting yourself further by making poor decisions, perhaps, by lack of comprehension of the matters that you hadn't comprehended that had been kept you up at night for causing insomnia, for which you take the stupid little sleeping pill, which leads you to sleep very well, perhaps, and remain oblivious to the very important reasoning, thinking, understanding process of that which had been keeping you up at night. Please. So Don, knowing something about that, asks Ra to address it, their light, to to this zone. Ross says, this query is convoluted. However, we shall make some observations in lieu of attempting one coherent answer, for that which is allopathic among your healing practices is somewhat two-sided. Firstly, and I'll just read these three paragraphs. Firstly, you must see the probability that each and every allopathic healer is in fact a healer. Within your cultural nexus, this training is considered the appropriate means of perfecting the healing ability. In the most basic sense, any allopathic healer may be seen to, perhaps, be one whose desire is service to others in alleviation of bodily complex and mental-emotional complex distortions, so that the entity to be healed may experience further catalyst over a longer period of what you call the life. This is a great service to others, when appropriate, due to the accumulation of distortions towards wisdom and love, which can be created through the use of the space-time continuum of your illusion. Second paragraph. In observing the allopathic concept of the body complex as the machine, deus ex machina, we may note the symptomology of a societal complex seemingly dedicated to the most intransigent desire for the distortions of distraction, anonymity, and sleep. This is the result, rather than the cause, of societal thinking upon your plane. Third, in turn, this mechanical concept of the body complex has created the continuing proliferation of distortions towards what you would call ill health, due to the strong chemicals used to control and hide bodily distortions. There is a realization among many of your peoples that there are more efficacious systems of healing, not excluding the allopathic, but also including the many other avenues of healing. And that's the point, is spiritual development is inclusive, not exclusive. Development of consciousness, is accumulative. The person who's activated in fifth chakra, well, truly developed fifth chakra, is not only wisdom developed, but also love developed. You know, fifth chakra life is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, not only 5. And so, it's important to use whatever works and admit and accept and integrate whatever is true. There are elements of allopathic healing that are very helpful, and that's Ra's first, you know, Ra is a master, is an enlightened being, or more or less, you know, is the master of the temple, or at least a good senior student here, and says there are two sides to the matter. One is that, in fact, these people who are doctors and psychiatrists, particularly, in the, they're accredited with their regulations and their social standing. In fact, they may really be healers, shockingly. Some of them really are pure in their intention to be of service to others, even though they're laboring under the allopathic delusion that the body complex is a machine, or the mechanical concept of the body complex, or a mechanical view of what body is. Body as a machine, as a lump of flesh, or a mechanical billiard board that is simply born of and operates under a physical law independent of something called mind or spirit or karma. They have no idea of the spiritual nature of body. Body as an energy system associated with mind, associated with causal stream, past, present, and future. They don't know that at all. That's why it's called personal psychology, not transpersonal. The transpersonal understands the higher dimensions of mind or a deeper understanding of what body is beyond its physical, mechanical properties. Then Ra is saying that, well, first of all, any allopathic healer may really be a healer. In society, in the world today, going into, becoming a Western doctor or allopathic doctor is, offered as the way to help others through physical healing. There are not really so many options for people who want to be a healer of body in any official formal way outside the Western, you know, medical profession. So any healer, any doctor in that tradition may really be somebody who has pure desire to serve others, to alleviate, Ross said, bodily complex and mental emotional distortions, meaning body symptomology and psychological distress, body-mind. So the doctor and the psychiatrist. And what is the purpose of healing? Well, Ra gives the most simple level, I think, which is that the person may live longer. They may experience further catalyst over a longer period of life and may live longer and not die younger because they're working through their catalyst or healing body, mind, to the point where they don't have to die young because they're not listening or learning. They're not distilling love light by their life. That's the great value of, you know, medical and psychiatric intervention. Successful medical psychiatric intervention helps the person live longer, so that they may distill more love light or use their life experience catalyst, life catalyst, to continue on their spiritual path, you know, for the future. And so, this is the accumulation of distortions towards wisdom and love created through the use of space-time continuum of your illusion. Only ETs talk like this. So this means the value of having longer time in space-time, longer experience in space-time, longer incarnation. This is the use of the space-time continuum of your illusion, so that the person can develop more love wisdom. But in the case of the current delusion of the medical profession and the psychiatric profession, their current delusion that the body is a machine, body complex as a machine, or the mechanical concept of body, this, in Ra's opinion, and Ra doesn't pull any punches here, this is a symptom, a result of a societal sickness, the vast sinkhole of indifference, the distortions which infect your people whose depths they cannot plumb. This is this notion that the body is a machine or a mechanical product is the result, in Ra's opinion here, of the dedication of human society to a profound desire for distraction, anonymity, and sleep. So I've used this triad often. This is a simplistic but very deep-cutting analysis of three aspects of human society, or three of the guiding desire, attachments, tendencies, habitual ways of being of Earth humanity. The 3D repeater. The 3D repeater psychology, right? The triadic basis of the 3D repeater psychology being intransigent desire, intransigent meaning unshakable, pervasive, deeply rooted and hard to get rid of. Distortion, desire for distortions, desire for distraction, anonymity, and sleep. Distraction, I see basically as associated with physical engagement or body. You know, I see in this triad, body, mind, spirit, the triadic nature of our being. Body is devoted to distractions, right? You know, going to amusement parks. I mean, there are countless things that are not problematic. You see, activity that we may call distraction, right? Watching, you know, Eminem sing. You know, going to color party, color dust-throwing festivals. Is it a distraction? Well, it depends on the consciousness of the people there. But in many cases, distraction to me is undue emphasis or a high valuation on that which is ultimately meaningless, other than you know, the seeking or the acquisition of very impermanent sensations of happiness and pleasure, the seeking of very short term, you know, very short term goal, distraction of body attention or body engagement, what we do with our body. We engage in distraction. Distraction is lack of focus. It's 1, 2, 3. It's, you know, sitting on the back of the motorbike staring into the cell phone. Anonymity at the level of mind or heart or society is the profound lack of community of humanity on Earth. Profound, and it's very galling and painful for wanderers who haven't recognized why they feel anomie or distress, existential angst, is people are really are disassociated from each other, disconnected, disunified. And that's the profound mind-to-mind or relational anonymity of Earth humanity. Sleep means a complete unwillingness to seek spiritually or to seek the answer. And these tendencies of body, mind, spirit in human civilization, Earth human civilization, the 3D repeater psychology, leads to the delusion that body is a machine. Then, Ra said, this delusion, I call it a delusion, a strong delusion, that the body is a machine, leads to this continuing proliferation or continuing ill health of Earth humanity due to strong chemicals used to control and hide body distortions or symptoms. Treating the symptoms, not the causes, the specialty of Western medicine, at least pharmaceutical culture, pharmacia, pharmacopoeia, meaning witchcraft. It's a kind of Babylonian witchcraft. Pharmacopoeia, pharmacia, is a Babylonian witchcraft, which is strong chemicals. You know, you ever look at the name of drugs and pharmaceuticals? They have some pretty weird names, huh? You don't think those are Babylonian black magical spells? You're damn right they are. So, be careful. Be careful. Such, you know, 3D psychology, collective psychology giving rise to this profound continuing desire for distraction, anonymity, and sleep, which is basically, eating tasteless food. Tasteless, non-nutritional food. The person has this continuing desire to eat more because whatever they're eating doesn't do the trick. It doesn't have a taste, it doesn't satisfy, and it doesn't nourish. And so they want more and more and more. And that's, you know, the basis of distraction. That leads to, ultimately, you know, these tendencies give rise to a the distorted misunderstanding of body as a machine, which gives rise to the idea that, you know, just give this machine the right chemicals to degunk it, or to make this and that change over here or over there. These are, you know, the Babylonian pharmacopoeia, pharmacia, strong chemicals that control and hide distortions, meaning don't treat underlying causes of illness. Of course, bone setting and things like that are quite good, but pharmaceuticals, you know, they just can't help you. They're just not going to help. They get rid of symptoms. But symptoms are results of causes, and the causes are not healed, ultimately, by pharmaceuticals. Now, it may be in some cases, sure, but let the buyer beware. Ra's saying, finally, yes, there is realization of many people now of these dynamics, that there are more efficient, efficacious ways of healing than strong chemicals used to treat a body that is considered a machine. But again, we don't need to exclude the allopathic, but include more. Not either or, but both and. Getting close to the end here. Let's see how far we can go. 6416. Let us assume that a bodily distortion occurs within a particular entity, who then has a choice of seeking allopathic aid or experiencing the catalyst of the distortion and not seeking correction of the distortion. Can you comment on the two possibilities for this entity and his analysis of each path? Two ways of working with sickness or body illness. They either can go to the Western-trained medical doctor, allopathic aid, or Don is saying, experiencing the catalyst of the distortion, meaning experiencing the symptom itself. This not seeking correction of the distortion is, I think, a misphrasing, because he doesn't mean that the person just sits experiencing the catalyst and does nothing. What I think he means is not seeking external allopathic correction or alleviation of the body symptom, but works on it mentally or alone. Ra said, if the entity is polarized towards service to others, analysis properly proceeds along the lines of consideration of which path offers the most opportunity for service to others. For the negatively polarized entity, the antithesis is the case. For the unpolarized entity, the considerations are random and most likely in the direction of the distortion towards comfort. Ra didn't perhaps, you know, you see, Don's question can be answered only to the depth that it's a clear, comprehensive, clearly formulated question. If the question is confused, Ra's answer sometimes can't go so deep. If you don't know what you're asking, you're not going to get a great answer. So 50% of the answer is formulating a precise question. If you really want to know something, get clear exactly what it is you want to know. Your process of getting clear exactly what you want to know is the majority of the distance to the answer. You know, a clear configuration of the question or a targeting of my seeking has the target in scope, in view, clearly configuring exactly what you wish to know is an essential focusing that leads very directly. You've got the target sighted. What do I want to know? And if you ask a confused question, you get a very kind of unhelpful answer generally. Not always, but you know, it's very important to ask, to get clear about what you don't know and what you want to know, if you wish to know. Doing that is the bulk of the work, actually. Getting ready for the work is the most important part of the work, actually. Because then from here to there is a straight line, and you already know where you're going. Anyway, the analysis here of how do differently polarized humans, positive, negative, and neutral, deal with the choice of how to treat or heal illness or body distortion. Ra's saying, for those that are service to other, like us, analysis properly proceeds along the lines of consideration which path offers most opportunity for service to others. Meaning, if I go to the hospital, you see, this is, you have to tweak this a lot. If I have a cold, and I'm thinking how to handle it. Should I go to the allopathic healer, go to the hospital? Or should I, sit at home and take ginger tea and do a little exercise and talk to the sun and go into the trees and meditate and this and that? Well, it would seem that going to the hospital 10 times and taking their medicine and getting more sick and taking more medicine and getting more sick gives me more chance to be in the hospital, to be talking to the people there and helping them, right? maybe not. So, what's the most opportunity for service to other? Is it going to the doctor 20 times because the medicine doesn't work? Or I keep getting sick and I take everything, I know, I say, give me more? That's shallow analysis. But perhaps staying alone and take care of it yourself, because it retains, if one can do it, depending on the illness and the process and the person, if one can do it, one returns to bright mind, balanced body faster, from which one can radiate love light globally better than going to the hospital 20 times because the medicine you take doesn't help and you keep getting sick, but you have more time to be in front of people. So that's a strange way of looking at it, but ultimately, when we make the right choice, it is a right choice because it supports world service better. than the wrong choice. And that world service may be simply the result of that which is better for us alone in any one decision point. Meaning, do the right thing. Why is it the right thing? It's beneficial. It's skillful. How? It's moral. It's ahimsa. Okay. Well, going to the hospital may be ahimsa. Going to the hospital 20 times is ahimsa. I'm not hurting anybody there. Staying home and doing it alone in 2 days is ahimsa because I'm not hurting myself. I'm helping. But which is the right choice? Most service to other. Right? Most opportunity for service to other. This is a very blocky way of thinking. But the right choice or the best way of handling decision points, the best course of action at decision points, is a best choice because or in association with how it does better support service to others than the wrong choice or the less less worthy choice. But it may not involve being with people, and it may be much more subtle. So this is just a funny way of looking at that. That which is the best choice ultimately leaves us energy consciousness beings more rapidly in a balanced condition. Thereby we can be at our best. To be with others, but also to be as a radiatory influence for all. Then the negative entity decides, you know, how can I screw people better? Taking allopathic or taking it, doing it alone. Or how can I dominate and control better? And that's how they analyze things. For the entity who's not polarized, and this is a little kind of a little hint, which we may already know, but it's an interesting point, that those that are unpolarized, meaning they're not committed to virtue or vice, the vast sinkhole of indifference, Ross said, moral indifference, moral apathy, moral bafflement, moral paralysis. That is the condition of Earth today, baby, whether you know it or not. That's been the condition all the way. That's the basis of 3D repeater, 3D repeating, 3D reincarnative repeating, based in 3D psychology, deeply associated with indifference, is basically distorted towards comfort, comfort seeking. If closing my eyes and not seeing an oncoming disaster is more comfortable, I'll do it. If following the lies of smiling, bejeweled royalty and politicians and following what they tell me leads me to more comfort, I'll do so. If eating the junk food that hurts my body leads me to be happy in the moment, I'll do it. The avoidance of truth is ultimately comfort seeking. The unwillingness to think and moral relativism and moral apathy is ultimately a result of comfort-seeking, is ultimately a result of 3D repeater psychology, a result of those that are not polarized. So non-polarization means amorality, amoral, not moral, meaning morality is considered unimportant. Comfort is considered most important, or security, you know? That's very much critical to the decision-making process or the mind. Some strange creature on my leaves. Oh, a bird. Oh, and we have a lot of beings around these days. Anyway, the unpolarized, the 3D repeater, and this will be the end for today. The 3D repeater is a repeater because of 3D repeating psychology, their own psychology, their own mental, intellectual conditions. They're not bad, but cause leads to effect. And the cause is conditions of mind, are conditions of mind associated with moral valuation, or the hierarchy of values and view. And Ra is basically saying that in general, for those that are unpolarized, there is no order or organization to how they necessarily would make this decision, allopathic healer or take care of it myself and work it through by mind, or, you know, by an internal process. But this is applicable in many ways to the decision-making process, or the values and the consciousness, the perspective of the unpolarized, the masses, the what, 95% of humans on Earth? You know, what's the harvest going to be? 5%? 8%? So we're talking about 90% or so, or 80% that are significantly unpolarized, or at least, you know, not harvestable doesn't mean non-polarized, but there are a lot of people, maybe 50%, okay, who are morally morally paralyzed, indifferent, apathetic. And ultimately, that mind seeks short-term comfort and short-term gain and is easily duped by negatives and is the ultimate reason for the proliferation of Orion influence on Earth. The mind of the majority that rejects moral consideration or a deep analysis of deeper value or greater value. Anyway, next time we'll start at 6417 about Bigfoot and some discussion of balancing. We don't have a lot left in this session, only five or so. And we'll see what we do. We might do a shorter talk next time, or I'll give a longer discussion about balancing. Anyway, thank you so much for being here today. I hope it was helpful. I appreciate your being here. Take good care of yourselves, and good night.